Very significant day, and I thank Indian Waterworks Association Mumbai Center that I got this opportunity to make a presentation on ductile iron pipes at gravity sewer network. I would like to concentrate basically on 2-3 subjects because the presentation is quite exhaustive. I don't want to test the patience of the audience, but definitely I would like to concentrate on issues that are very significant to transportation of sewerage. Before I start the presentation, I must tell you I come from a background of metal pipes. So if you see in the world today, metal pipes, the two most challenging things in the metal pipe industry all over the world are corrosion control, which is a very interesting field of engineering, and secondly, reducing carbon footprint, because in making the input raw material into steel or iron, unfortunately we end up emitting a lot of carbon dioxide into air. So it is incumbent on the metal pipe industry and also other kinds of metallurgical plants to reduce carbon footprint emission in line with the Paris Climate Accord of 2015, in which India is also a signatory. Now, as far as the carbon footprint part is concerned, we can meet on some other day and discuss. And today I will discuss more to do with what Electrosteel as a group is doing about corrosion engineering with respect to ductile iron pipes, and of course in terms of specific application with respect to sewerage transmission, that is mostly gravity sewage. Once again, before I come to the main topic, so I have told you what is the topic I will be dealing with. I'll tell 2-3 lines about Electrosteel as a group. It actually consists of two companies. One is Electrosteel Castings Limited, which actually manufactures ductile iron pipes and ductile iron fittings. And the plant is located near Kolkata, and it caters to the eastern, northeastern and the northern markets. It is incidentally an export oriented unit. The other plant that we have is in Andhra Pradesh near Tirupati, the Sri Kalahasti Pipes Limited, which caters to the southern and the western markets. It is essentially a ductile iron pipe plant. It does not manufacture DI fittings. Put together, Electrosteel Group today manufactures 6.5 lakh ton ductile iron pipes annually. We started with a 45,000 ton plant. We are the innovators. You see, this is 25 years of DI pipes, so which means that we brought actually DI pipes to India. All the other industries followed. It's also because that we have been developing products and we have been developing markets, which others are taking benefit of today. Now let us come to the exact presentation. We'll not talk much about the ductile iron per se, because I think these are some kind of slides we have been showing to people for the last 25 years. So it gets very boring to, you know, discuss these things in a gathering. After 25 years, there's no point in talking what is ductile iron. I mean, if people don't know what is ductile iron, we are great failures. So we'll not discuss this.
But there are students.
Yeah, so I'll tell you
very briefly.
Very briefly I'll touch upon this. Ductile error actually combines the, you see, there are two, there used to be two kinds of metal pipe options before the advent of ductile iron, and those were those are basically, one is wear and the other is cast iron and mild steel. So mild steel is known for its high mechanical strength, and cast iron is known for its high corrosive properties, corrosive resistant properties. Ductile iron, in a way, combines the best of the both. So with ductile iron coming into the market, cast iron got completely obliterated from all markets of the world. Mm-hmm. It still lingers on in India, because after all it is India, and also because there are takers for cast iron pipes still in India, but it's a very limited quantity that is being sold in India. And ductile iron also has eaten into the market of steel pipes for water application. But steel pipes, of course, are used for oil and gas transmission, where ductile iron has no scope. Now, this is a typical cross-section of a ductile iron pipe. What I will do is, our senior representatives, Mr. F.M. Patel and Mr. Vishwanathan, they have a copy of this presentation. They can take it on a pen drive and install it in the computer of some of the senior IWWA people, and then they can by email transmit it all across, whoever are interested and present here. Because if you go into the depths of these, you know, each slide takes a lot of time.
We'll give it.
Yeah. Properties of ductile iron. So basically properties of ductile iron are very similar to mild steel. Now, coming to, this is something important. You see, coming to sewerage transmission, we have to understand that there are two kinds of sewerage environment in a conduit. One is a non-septic environment in which the threat is, threat from anaerobic corrosion is less, which is pressurized flow, full flow. The other is, which is mostly in gravity sewer, what we find is that the pipe or the conduit is partially full, which means that there is air inside the gap, and there is a possibility of hydrogen sulfide evolving out of the sewage, interacting with the oxygen within that gap and converting itself into sulfuric acid. Now this sulfuric acid, essentially what it happens is, it eats into the crown level of the pipe, that is the top of the pipe, and slowly it reduces the thickness of whatever pipe that you provide, which means that the mechanical strength or the moment of inertia of that pipe or the conduit is getting reduced, and after some time it can structurally fail because of a combination of three reasons. One is the soil overburden, the other is the surcharge that is on the surface, and the other is the traffic loading, which is also cyclic in nature. So basically this diagram tells us the tragic story of whatever sewerage transmission or conveyance is all about. That is the septic sewerage transmission. Now, these are some of the photographs. We can go through this because... Now, ductile iron pipes are strong pipes. But for gravity sewer transmission, you don't require typically very strong pipes, because it's a non-pressure transmission. But you do require a strong pile, essentially because, number one, the soil overburden is there, the surcharge on the soil is there, and huge cyclic traffic loading is there. Now, RCC pipes have typically been very popular in this sector because we all know, I think most of us are civil engineers here, we all know that concrete is very strong in compression and weak in tension. Whereas iron and steel are very susceptible to compression and very strong against tension. So we are basically talking basics here, fundamentals. So what happens is, since ductile iron is an iron pipe, so one would tend to question the compressive stresses that are being created because of the external top loading. How strong will the pipe be against these kind of compressive stress creating forces? The thickness of ductile iron pipes is standardized all over the world, and the design standard that standardizes the thickness of ductile iron pipes all across the world is International Standard 10803, which means that a ductile iron pipe sold in Spain for a specific class has the same thickness as whatever is being sold in Maharashtra. And these are designed for various kinds of load combinations, like they say ASHTO, as you know, for what we have Indian Road Congress for our class 70R, class A, class A loading. In America they have got ASHTO loading, and it's a wartime loading, which means where patent tanks have been unleashed onto the on the road, and 5 metric ton per meter square is the surcharge, and whatever is the soil loading, soil conditions, and you have to also factor in the trenching conditions. You have to understand that when we are talking of gravity sewerage, we are also talking of very high overburden depths, which means there will be an optimum level beyond which the soil loading will be critical in guiding the thickness of the pipe, and before which the cyclic traffic loading and the surcharge loading will be critical in guiding the thickness of the pipe. So all these combinations and permutations have been worked out in ISO 10803. It's a public document, everybody can access it, and in IS 8329, which is the Indian standard for ductile iron pipes, for water, sewage and gas, the referral standard for thickness design is ISO 10803. So these are standardized all over the world. So these thicknesses are good enough. K7 thicknesses are good enough for your non-pressure but high compressive stress creating environment pipes. Because you know that for RCC pipes there is a typical test, 3H bearing test is there. So similarly, ISO 10803 through this Spangler equation defines all the thicknesses. In fact, we have built up a software also on that ISO 10803. We can share it with our senior representatives in the Mumbai office, and that can be shared with you all, and you will have the freedom to design any kind of steel pipe thicknesses or ductile iron pipe thicknesses. But the critical difference between a ductile iron pipe or a steel pipe is steel pipe thicknesses are customized for every occasion. You can buy a specific thickness of a coil and manufacture a pipe of specific thickness for X application and Y application. But because ductile iron pipes are centrifugally cast, the designs are pre-customized, which means a K7 pipe will have a specific thickness even for, so it's a bit of a over design. In such a case, the factor of safeties are higher. So we have talked about K7 pipes. We also will talk about something called socket and spigot joints. This is very critical because I come from a place called Kolkata, which was earlier called Calcutta. When I was a student in Jadavpur University, there was a huge outbreak of jaundice. It was because the concrete joints had caved in because of the metro construction, underground railway construction. And the entire sewage was outflowing from those joints and mixing with the water carrying pipes. And people were actually drinking sewage water. And there was a huge epidemic of jaundice in 1988, the year I passed out from Jadavpur University. So I still remember that. So in a way, ductile iron pipe joints are also very important. Socket and spigot joints are tested for 50 kg per centimeter square, 0.9, minus 0.9 kg per centimeter square negative pressure under various kinds of cyclic loadings. So joints are type tested under such stringent conditions that you can never have with a properly laid ductile iron pipe exfiltration or exfiltration of sewage or infiltration of subsoil or water. It's not as if that infiltration of subsoil water does not create any problem. It does. It does. Because it entirely changes the specific gravity of the sewage being transported and the entire downstream treatment philosophies that are adopted in designing the system. Now, what is very important to discuss here is point number 2 and point number 3, on which we will talk for 10 minutes. You see, we brought in this high alumina cement mortar and polyurethane lining, which are applied at factory, not at site. High alumina cement mortar lining and polyurethane lining, both are done by centrifugal process, but they have to basically satisfy type tests for chemical resistance and abrasion resistance. Now, if one has to quantify what is the, let us say, corrosive resistance of a RCC pipe or a DWC HDP pipe, or let's say for any other pipe that are being used for sewage transmission, they do not have such quantitative measurement. But in case of ductile iron pipes with these kind of linings, there are quantitative measurements to measure the impact of actual corrosion, impact of actual abrasion your fluid is going to create in the expected or the design environment. So I have named certain clause numbers. ISO 7186 is the international standard for ductile iron products for sewage applications, and EN598 is the European standard for ductile iron pipes, fittings, accessories and their joints for sewage applications. Now, what are these type tests? These are important to know because the test procedures are similar for both high alumina cement as well as polyurethane lining. And external coating, we are also very significantly saying about external coating for the simple reason that the kind of things, I mean, people who have actually done sewage transmission networks would know that digging a pit, a 6 meter, 8 meter deep pit in Indian conditions, what you can actually find there. That underground looks like absolute gutter. So the external environment could be very, very corrosive compared to what you can expect under design considerations. So we have got 130 grams per meter square zinc base with a finishing layer of red epoxy or brown bitumen, coating of 70 microns applied at factory. For soils of higher corrosivity, higher thickness of zinc coating can be used. along with or without polyethylene sleeving. Now it can be zinc with 200 grams per meter square, zinc with 400 grams per meter square, with or without polyethylene sleeving. And we also sell in the European and the Middle Eastern markets zinc aluminium coating, which is a very tough coating. So let's look at the kind of type test. Now this I'll come later, because this is also very interesting for it, actually for no. You see, the cement that goes into manufacturing, the high alumina cement that goes into manufacturing high alumina cement mortar lined ductile iron pipes is Calcote RG. It is imported from France, because Indian cements, high alumina cements, do not satisfy the requirements of EN 598 or ISO 7186 type test requirements. Now let's look at what are the test requirements and the testing conditions. Now it says, except for components intended only for the transport of rainwater, long-term performance of pipes, fittings and joints shall be demonstrated by 6-month exposure test. Please remember, 6-month exposure test to an acid solution and to an alkaline solution. Their field of use is given in Annexure C. Now this acid solution is basically pH 3, the limiting value of pH is 3, and for alkaline solution the limiting factor is pH 30. So you have to operate between an environment of pH 3, which is the allowable factor is pH 3 to pH 30. Normally the sewage that we transport in India typically is somewhere between 4 and 4.5. It can go even below that, because in the name of sewage, what flows in our pipes can be an action thriller. Now, after 6 months of testing, the following conditions shall be met. Thickness of the cement mortar lining shall be within 0.2 millimeter of the original thickness. There shall be no visible cracking, blistering or disbonding of the epoxy or polyurethane based coatings. That is for polyurethane based coatings. Fittings, pipe spigots and sockets and pipe linings. Which means that for thick cement mortar lining, you see, this quantification is very significant. 0.2 millimeter of the original thickness. If the original thickness, is, let's say, is 4 millimeter, it cannot go beyond 3.8 millimeter after 6 months of testing at pH 3 or pH 30, the extreme conditions of testing. And in case of polyurethane based coatings, no visible cracking, blistering or disbonding of the epoxy, which means that it is as if in the original shape when it was coated. I'll show you the type test certificates also for these, which has been conducted by British Standards Institution. There shall be no visible cracking on the rubber gasket. Its hardness, tensile strength and elongation shall remain in conformity with the specified values. All other combinations of coatings may be tested according to the same procedure. The values of pH may be modified in order to demonstrate long-term behavior in different environments. For abrasion resistance, please note the quantification. The pipes shall not have an abrasion depth greater than 0.6 millimeter after 1 lakh movements or 50,000 cycles for every type of cement lining, or 0.2 millimeter for epoxy or polyurethane linings. I hope the matter is clear. Am I very clear that we have actually quantified that in case of corrosion resistance, we need 6 months of exposure to pH 3 as well as pH 13, and it cannot go below 0.2 millimeter. And in case of abrasion test, after 50,000 cycles or 1 lakh movements, you cannot go below 0.6 millimeter from the original thickness, nominal thickness of cement mortar lining. So we have quantified what we require. How this quantification has been made? That by achieving this standard, we will be able to create a lifespan of 100 years for ductile iron pipes. These kind of lines. Very recently, ISO 21053 has come out, which is basically the life cycle cost analysis for ductile iron pipes. It clearly states the life cycle of ductile iron pipes as 100 years, covering various kinds of applications. Now, IS 8329 also says something about high laminar cement mortar lining. That is, the minimum value of pH is 4, maximum content of aggressive carbon dioxide, sulfates, magnesium, ammonia, no limit. So, high laminar cement mortar lining can actually take limitless amount of aggressive carbon dioxide, sulfates, magnesium and ammonium, and the limiting value of pH as per IS 8329 is 4. pH value is 4. But it does not have the type test provisions. These are basically the type test certificates. You can see the that BSIE actually stands for British Standards Institution. This is the actual type test certificate. You can see here DN 400 and 450 pipes. Spun pipe sample lined with type ISTRA 50 high laminar cement mortar lining. Spun pipe sample lined with type Calcot RG high laminar cement mortar lining. Now, ISTRA 50 and Calcot RG both are imported cements from France. Now, when availability of ISTRA 50 is not there, we get Calcot RG. When availability of Calcot RG is not there, we get ISTRA 50. So both are compatible with EN 598 type test requirements. Now, this is the type test certificate done by NSF, stands for the French Accreditation Body for polyurethane lined ductile iron pipes. So it has been given to Electro Steel Castings Bajberia, which is the factory or the plant which does the polyurethane lining. So the entire description shows. So when you get the presentation, you will be able to read the entire type test certificate. So very acceptable bodies, if you consider British Standards Institution and the French National Accreditation Body as acceptable bodies, they have given these certificates to our process and systems that are being followed. Now, this presentation also covers something about hilly terrain. There are no hilly terrain as such in Maharashtra, but yes, in hilly terrain, what happens is, just I'll say, in undulating terrain, if you have a sewerage network, it will not be typically a gravity network per se, because it will be a full flow pressurized network. There you don't require HSE lining or polyurethane lining, because anaerobic corrosion is not a threat there. What you require there is sulfate resistant cement mortar lining. Now, these are service lives given by NIRI. Now, in fact, ISO has also come to 21053. So NIRI says that the design useful service life of DI pipes is 70 and 90 years. Minimum and maximum are 70 and 90 years. In case of ISO 21053, it says 100 years. IWWA specifies it as 105 years. But these life cycles are important to conduct the life cycle analysis, cost analysis of various kinds of pipe materials in sewer application. For that matter, any kind of application. Your I hope you all know that defense deals are done on the basis of life cycle cost analysis. You must have read in the newspaper a lot about life cycle cost analysis of Rafale aircrafts. So you should be aware about this concept. Now we will go through the main parts of what the CPHO manual says, that what should be the philosophy in selecting a sewer pipe material. Every sewer pipe has merits and demerits. It will be useful to keep in mind. Now this is, I'm not speaking, this is CPHO manual. It is quote unquote from CPHO manual. It will be useful to keep in mind that sewers pass through a whole length of roads in a habitation, and varying soil conditions, bedding conditions, location, etc. will be encountered at various places. Hence, a particular pipe material may be suitable in a particular location but may require some other material at some other locations. A guide for this is presented in Appendix 8.3.10. That is the manual on sewerage and sewerage treatment system published by CPHO in 2013. Care shall be taken that in high groundwater locations and coastal locations, the sewer pipes shall not be stoneware or vitrified clay pipes, and instead shall be cast iron or ductile iron pipes or other non-metallic pipes with safeguards against rotation, as discussed later in the section on laying of sewers. Now, there have been 9 issues that have been flagged in the CPHO manual, which will be the guiding criteria in selecting a sewer transmission pipe. Flow characteristics, availability in the sizes required including fittings, ease of handling and installation, water tightness and simplicity of assembly, physical strength, resistance to acids, alkalis, gases, solvents, etc., which I think we have specifically discussed, resistance to scour, durability, cost including handling and installation. The manual notes that no single material can meet all the conditions that may be encountered in sewer design. So selection should be made for the particular application, and different materials may be selected for parts of a single project, which is very important, because in an underground drainage project, you actually require typically thousands of kilometers of pipes. Now, if you specify a single material for the entire requirement, you are going to land up in a shortfall of pipes, and that will delay the project. So it is important and significant to have a bouquet of pipe materials depending upon various characteristics, so that you are able to keep the supply chain of the pipe at site for installation works. Now we made a comparison between characteristics of RCC pipe as per IS 458-2003, characteristics of DWC HDP pipes as per IS 16098 part 2, characteristics of DI pipe as per IS 8329-2000. And against all various headings or flagged issues, the comparison has been made. It is very detailed, so I don't want to go into this. You can basically, actually, provisions of standards and CPHO guidelines, NIRI manuals, international standards have been incorporated here verbatim. So there is no, these are facts. These are not views about pipe products. Now, one of the issues that people want to see about is cost. You see, I have got a few projects approved by CPHO with DI pipes from various states, and there I found initially there was a lot of resistance in using DI pipes in sewerage projects because of the perception of cost. Now, when they worked out the cost per se, then they really found that the cost increase is very insignificant compared to the advantages that you are getting in the project by using ductile iron pipes. Now, in a specific RUIDP project, that is in Rajasthan, we found that total as-laid cost of the pipeline as per RUIDP SOR with cost of sewer with a combination of DWC, HDP and RCC pipes was coming out to 10 crores 68 lakhs. Whereas with DWC, HDP, DIK7 between 350 and 700 and DWC, HDP, we were able to bring the cost at around 11.6 crores. So the percentage increase in the total as-laid cost of pipeline is 8.52%, but in the overall cost of the project, the impact was only 0.6%. Similarly, in another project, while the percentage increase in the as-laid cost of the pipeline was 17.37%, but the overall impact in the total project cost, the package or the EPC package for which the project has been tendered, is only 0.94%. Now, life cycle cost analysis has been explained here. Now, this is from Odisha Water Supply and Sewerage Board, which is the approved project that has gone approved by CPHU and Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, and that has gone for external funding assistance, and most probably it will receive KFW funding. Here, finally, the pipe material selected was RCC MP3 class pipe 800 to 1200 dia, DI from 300 mm to 700 mm, DWC HDP pipe from 200 to 250. So what you are doing is, you are using a bouquet of pipe materials and you are essentially trying to use the diametric advantage of each pipe material considering the terrain and topographical conditions of your specific project site. Now, this 300 to 700 in your case could be 400 to 800. In somebody's case, it could be 250 to 600. So, it has to be evaluated on a project to project basis. Now, what we did was, as per the entire Bahrampur project, we evaluated on the basis of MJP schedule of rates, because the Bahrampur project in Odisha was based on the Odisha SOR. So these are the Maharashtra RCC NP3 pipes, the FOR DWC HDP pipes, and the FOR Maharashtra DK7, DIK7 pipes. So if you have option 1, the option 1 is RCC pipes and DWC HDP pipes. So your also K7 pipes. So your cost of the project is 32 crores, option 1. And option 2 is DWC up to 250 and RCC pipe above 250, 69.28 crores. So there is a marginal increase of around 2.5 crores over a base cost of 70 crores. Then what you do is, the CPHO has done, they have done a life cycle cost analysis. So they found that option 1 is more economical, based on which they have approved the Bahrampur design. That the life cycle cost with DI pipe is 121 crores. Whereas the life cycle cost with no DI is 127 crores. So they have done the life cycle cost analysis on the basis of the foundations that have been given in the CPHO manual and other standards all across the world. and worked on it, and they found out that the option with DI, DWC and RCC pipes, depending on the diameter matrix, diameter versus pipe matrix, that is coming out to be more economical. So I don't want to conclude anything because it's a decision. You see, every decision maker has to take based on his own project. So I'm nobody to conclude. But I would say that there is a suggested pipe matrix which one can work on very broadly. That for valley terrain, I say the plain land areas where there is a threat of what I say is septic corrosion. One can use DWC HDP SN8 pipe up to a diameter of 250 millimeter and DIK7 pipe with HSC lining from 300 to 700 millimeter and RCC pipe above 700 millimeter. Now it's a call you have to take whether you want to take RCC pipes with HSC lining or polyethylene lining or PVC lining, because RCC pipes with polyethylene lining and PVC lining, let me tell you, it will cost you through your nose. Those are even costlier than ductile iron pipes. For hilly terrain, I am saying where there is no threat of septic corrosion, you require very sturdy pipes. Use DIK7 pipes. In your case, it is not going to be hilly, it is undulating terrain. DIK7 pipes with SRC lining from 100 millimeter. And for pumping mains, one is using DIK9 pipes with SRC lining. Now, these are some of the photographs because we export a lot of hyaluminous cement mortar lined and polyurethane lined ductile iron pipes elsewhere, outside the country. Now, two stories I must tell you about. I heard a wonderful presentation before me. I had a lot of things to learn. You see, let me narrate to you a very sad story as far as gravity sewer transmission networks are concerned. You see, they cause a lot of nuisance in the civil society because of deep excavations, because of manholes, and when you dig in unplanned cities, unplanned areas, you have inventions. You have OFC cables, you have got electricity cables, you have got telephone cables, you have got, I mean, God only knows what kinds of cables are there, okay, for which you have actually no drawings or plans, or you dig and then you know what is there inside, and by that time you might have hit on a power line, somebody could have even died. So civil society, you know, does not react very well with underground drainage projects. So they are extremely politically sensitive. Politicians don't get votes because of underground drainage projects. They get votes with water supply projects. So I was not able to, I won't name the state, I won't name the politician or the bureaucrat, I won't even name the department. So a very good project was designed and I said that you have already done, invested so much with external funding on water supply, and what a crime you are doing by not doing the downstream underground transmission network followed by recycling, the sewage treatment plant, so and so forth, and using the sludge for compost digestion, etc. So he asked his bureaucrat, he asked his engineer in chief that what has been our experience with the last underground drainage project that we did? How many years did that take? He said 8 years. He told 8 years, which means that it will not even last my permanence in the assembly. So he said these projects, but how will the people take it? Suppose I go and, we were talking of election time, so suppose I go and inaugurate a project. So the bureaucrat a very seasoned man, a senior IAS officer, he said, sir, chances are you will be thrown rotten eggs on your face because they have had tremendous bad experience with the last project. So continuously water supply projects are getting installed in this country, politicians are getting votes, and you are not creating enough infrastructure for sewage transmission, sewage treatment and usage of the byproducts of what you are treating. Because whatever water you use, the moment you have used it, wastewater has been created. So it's a crime that is being trawled upon us in India. And it started, I can tell you the date. In it, IMF is also involved. In the first integrated water supply and wastewater project that went for IMF funding in Punjab. That was during the times of Pratap Singh Kairo, the legendary chief minister of Punjab. I'm not going to get into the details of the project, otherwise it will get very controversial. But the point is, we have to think as engineers, that we have to really create, there are innovations involved with this. Let us say, if you review the CPHO 2013 manual, a lot of representations were done in the last one and a half years before 2013 on pressurized sewerage network. I personally have discussed with lot of senior engineers all across India, and they say lot of benefit into investing in pressurized sewerage network system, by which you can do away with deep excavations, you can do away with manhole construction, but a lot of public participation is required, because every house will have to have a solar power integrated pump, a small pump to transport is the sewage from its septic tank to the main grid of the pipeline. So people need to participate. So I plan, because we have, there is an announcement of Jal Andolan. I really want to take it up with the central government ministry to give it some shape, because this is one of the progressive technologies we are taking up. We want to take up with the government, because until and unless we do this, we are throwing our cities into garbage dumps. So I think on this very significant day, we must ponder this point and find out a solution to this. Because everywhere, this is creating a major, major and a massive problem. Thank you so much.